education. Now, people want better food to eat. People want better housing. People need money. People need equality. People need understanding. People need freedom. And you better.
Welcome to another edition of Straight Talk. I'm your host, Tony Brown, and Reset is the show that cares about you and where the information comes from, the people to the people. And we like that. Come from the people to the people. And we have some people that's going to provide you with some information at this crucial time in our society. And one of the participants, or one of the persons that's going to be providing information, is Dr. Rosa Colquitt. Dr. Rosa Colquitt. I hope I'm saying it right. Am I saying it right, doctor?
I'll take that. It's actually Colquitt, but I really answer.
Okay, yeah, teamwork makes the dream work. Colquitt, we all good with that. And the doctor, she is the chairperson of the Democratic Party. I think I got that right, Democratic Party. But she's also
Oregon Black Caucus.
There you go,
Black Caucus.
Black Caucus. I just love that. See, that's straight talk. We just do it like that. And but she's also the administrator for the Biden and Harris campaign. So she's just like making it happen. And then also joining us is a young man. I say he's a Millennium Z or G, you know, but he's doing his thing. And it's Eddy Morales. And Eddy is stepping out, you know, like, you know, the Millennium is just doing the thing for us. And he's stepping out and he's on his way to be the mayor of Gresham. And he's putting his work into, so we're gonna be talking to him. Then we got also Miss Laura Palmer, who is a author and motivational speaker. She'll be joining us. And then we have another gentleman, Mr. Vincent Jones-Dixon. Now, Mr. Jones-Dixon has set history because he has become the first Black, Asiatic, African, whichever title person choose, in 3 decades to be elected as the city council in Gresham. So it's going to be awesome. I want everybody to stay tuned. We're going to get right into it. We're going to go with the doctor first, ladies first, and then Ms. Palmer jump in. And as we flow, everybody, we just flow with each other and we just get the information out. Welcome, doctor. Welcome, everybody.
Thank you.
Go to the doctor. Doctor.
Thank you for having us, Mr. Brown.
Hey, man, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure, Mr. Morales. And I'm going to speak it into existence. I can see you on that way to being, we might be saying, and very close to saying, Mayor Morales. Right?
And then, you know, we're going to have you at City Hall, of course, right?
Oh, man, hey, we'd love to be there. We'd love to be there. And so, is Mr. Vincent joined us? Mr. Vincent joined us yet?
Yes,
yeah,
sir.
Right
hey, welcome, sir. Welcome, sir. We're going to chat with you in a few minutes. We're going to go right over to the doctor. And, doctor, just share a little bit about, if you want, just however you want to bring it to us, the history of it, what you're doing, because you're all over in Hawaii and doing all kind of things. Come on, doctors.
Serve it up, doctor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brown. I'm really grateful that you would invite me into your program, give me a voice to talk a little bit about some of the work I'm doing. I was actually with a group that's in Hawaii tonight via Zoom, but it was really nice to have a chance to talk with them. We were doing a review of some of the issues that are related to a TV program about the United States in a state of being divided. And so we touched on some issues there. And I probably will talk about some of that as well. But before I talk about anything, I wanted to say to all of you that I have waited so long to vote for the November 3rd election, which is actually the day that the election ends, but we're in the middle of what I would describe as a voting season. But I would say to everybody that I have actually been waiting to vote since November 8, 2016. And I'm telling you that's a very, very long time, but that truly is how long I've been waiting to vote. Before I talk about anything else, I just want to make sure whomever is listening, and I don't know when this will be broadcast, But I want to make sure that everyone is aware of a link. It is called iwillvote.com. All you do is iwillvote.com. All you do is type it in. If you're in Hawaii, then it opens up to a link that tells you everything you need to do to check your voter registration status and tell you everything you need to do to vote in Hawaii. If you put iwillvote.com on your computer and you're in Portland, it will open up to Oregon, so you get all that you need. I couldn't be happier tonight than to begin with the words of my favorite president. I don't mind talking about some of my biases, and that is Barack Obama. He recently gave a call to what I would describe as a call to voter action, and he said, and I quote, "We've got to turn out like never, never before."
That's so true.
We cannot leave any doubt in this election. And adding to that is VP Biden's admonition to the North Carolina voters. I watched that with much anticipation. North Carolina is my old stomping grounds where I attended graduate school. He said, it's go time. Cast every vote. Count every vote. And that's what my life has been like about for the last 8 to 9 months, is being involved in voter registration and get out the vote. I spend an average, and I'm grateful for this time. I'm wearing down, but I'm very grateful for the time, but I spend an average of 3 to 4 hours daily in phone banking and text banking in the battleground states. For about a month, I did Michigan, but obviously the national campaign seems to feel that things are going a little better there. But for the last 3 weeks, I've spent all of my time either in Pennsylvania or Ohio. And it is really a privilege to get to talk to voters out of state and to find out what they're doing, how they're doing, why this election is important to them, how we came to where we are today. So all those things are very important. Something else I wanted to talk about, in addition to working with as an admin for the National Women for Biden campaign, working as the admin for Oregon Women for Biden Harris, I've also, through that opportunity, I had a chance to link up with a group of women. They are called Women of Color Coalition for Biden Harris. And that leadership comes through the state of New Jersey. And I have never been so excited and so privileged to meet Black women all over all over the US of A. And I would never have, I probably would not otherwise have been engaged with them had it not been for the National Women for Biden Harris campaign and meeting with these women to talk about the issues that impact women of color. And one of the most important things I've learned, I don't want to forget my mantra, and this is what we say when we meet via Zoom: we will not let them take our power, which is our vote. And that, I think, is a mantra for all of us as we get through what's just about to be the end of this voting season, to remember that we will not let them take our power. Our power is in our vote. So those are two of the campaigns that I've been working with, but I'll stop here before I go into three or four more of the others, because my life has been all about election 2020 for about 9 months, and I'm really burning out.
Well, Dr. Rosa, we don't see and we don't feel no burnout. I feel a whole lot of energy coming out of there. I definitely do. I don't know if Ms. Palmer is on yet, but if she's not, I'm going to go to two gentlemen. One of them is the incumbent councilman, and the other gentleman is running for mayor. And I'd like to say something at this point. I want to first give you a congratulation, Mr. Vincent John Dixon, for setting history. Yes, he set history. He is the first African-American, Asiatic, Black, whichever title person chooses, councilman in 3 decades. I hope I got that right. In 3 decades. Mr. Vincent, is that correct, sir?
That's correct. Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Brown. I Absolutely. Greatly appreciate it.
Absolutely. Yes. So I want the viewers to know, what is your platform this time around?
Yeah, that's a great question. Again, everyone, my name is Vince Jones-Dixon. I'm a current city councilor with the city of Gresham, and I'm running for re-election or for election this November for the same position number 3. I'm extremely passionate about 3 things. The first thing is public safety. So I'm looking forward to continuing the conversation around just community policing and defining what does that, or community safety, what does that look like and mean for us here in Gresham. Over the last 4 to 5 years, I've been engaged in conversations with the Gresham Police Department and the community around some of the concerns. And I'm looking forward to coming up with just new solutions for that in the form of partnering with community-based organizations and working with the police department and the community really to come up with solutions that work for us in Gresham and East County. And then the second thing is just community engagement. I'm a huge believer in meeting folks where we are, especially the African-American community and those that have been traditionally not engaged with the city, and really just engaging with them to get their input on what they would like to see here in the city, and working with them as it pertains to, working with everyone as it pertains to coming up with solutions that work best for us in Gresham. And then the final thing is just ownership, and that's both housing and entrepreneurship for both medium and low-income families. So working with our partners in Gresham and other community-based organizations to, again, find solutions that work best for us.
I'm gonna be coming back, Mr. Vincent. Again, congratulations. I'm gonna be coming back to that, but I wanna talk to a man that possibly, and it looks good, that might be your, I guess, your boss, huh? might be the mayor, so.
That's the story. Awesome friend, yes.
I want to bring on Eddy Morales, and he's running for the mayor in Gresham. And I believe, Mr. Morales, you are probably the first Hispanic?
Any person of color, yeah.
Any person of color. Wow, that's even a broader range. Okay. Welcome. And what is your platform?
Mr. Brown, thank you. First of all, thank you so much for having me on here.
My pleasure.
I love what it's about. Straight talk. I love who you have on your show. I was watching IBW, brothers and sisters from IBW on here talking about their experience, on the march on Washington. And, you have big fans of mine on your show tonight. Dr. Rosa Colquitt, who I get to serve as budget co-chair with the Democratic Party of Oregon. Councilor Vince Jones-Dixon, like you said, first Black male in the history of Gresham to ever be on the city council. And of course, first Black individual in at least 3 decades, way too long. And he definitely won't be the last. And then, Laurie Palmer, who one of the most powerful community advocates in our community with Go Get Your Child. And so I couldn't be in better company. I'm thrilled. I ran for city council 2 years ago. I've been at organizing for about 20 years and have organized on issues of immigration reform, the Dream Act, extending LGBTQ rights for people across the country, making sure that returning citizens get their right to vote back, and as well as just making sure that more Black, Indigenous, and people of color are participating in the political process, whether it's voting, the party, or actually running for office. And when I ran 2 years ago, it was because in Gresham, we are one of the most diverse places in the state of Oregon. Almost 40% of people who live here are either Black, Indigenous, or people of color. Almost 40%, just think about that. Wow. And about 20% of our population are non-US born. And I would say, Mr. Brown, that for the last 20 years, the people who've been in office really thought of this diversity as a deficit, as opposed, and a burden, as opposed to an asset. And so we started organizing 2 years ago. We started registering our community to vote, encouraging our community to run for office. And I'm really proud that in the last 2 years, we've been able to elect over 20 people for office, from school board all the way up to state legislature out here in East Multnomah County, Gresham. And just this last May, we elected 10 people of color for school boards in May. And so soon enough, we are going to have a government that represents the communities that live out here and that are responsive to the community and accountable to the communities that live out here. I'll just say three like brief points, and I hope we'll get into this stuff later. You know, I really want to make sure that we are bringing to the front and center our Black, Indigenous, and people of color, right? In the way that we make decisions, in the way that we allocate resources in the city, whether it's housing, whether it's transportation, parks and recreation, services, the wraparound services that our communities need, or economic development, right? That is actually meeting our communities where they're at and providing that economic opportunity and prosperity for our communities, particularly those that have not had access to those resources. To me, that's what equity looks like. You know, people talk about equity, and concretely, it's, do we have equitable, high quality housing for everyone in home ownership as well as renters? Do we have accessible transportation that is also equitable? Again, parks and recreation, are we setting up parks and things for our families to do? Not just in some neighborhoods, but all neighborhoods. And then are we doing this economic development that is really creating more economic opportunity and prosperity for our Black community and family members? And so those are just kind of a tip of the mark. Our city is in a pretty bad financial situation. It over the last 20 years, it's sort of been run into the ground. We're looking at a $13 million shortfall. And I just want to make sure that as we're balancing that budget, we're not doing it on the backs of people of color, right?
Now, it's interesting. I have each one of you here, and both of you pioneering and on the grind. And, but I want to give a historical perspective on this voting. It was not until 1965 that we received the right to vote. And I'm moving on up later. I mean, and Ms. Rose, you can, Dr. Rose, you can chime in on this. It was not until like the 18th or 19th Amendment that women even had the right to vote. And so here we are today. As a doctor, if you don't mind touching on that a little bit about how women feel about the historical perspective and what they're dealing with today. Dr. Rosa, you're muted.
Okay, I think I'm unmuted now. Thank you very much for that question. Even when women were given the right to vote, the Voting Rights Act came in 1965. And even then, I think it's very important that we not forget and that we constantly remind those who we're yet teaching and yet encouraging and yet motivating, because they are our future leaders, in terms of appreciating the journey where we came from as to where we are now. Even in 65, when as a policy matter, the Voting Rights Act granted us the ability to be able to vote, but the voter suppression was astronomical. Their homes were bombed just trying to register people to go and vote. And they were denied the right to vote when they showed up at the polls, or they were given some type of test to take that would have been impossible. I can't even begin to remember all of some of the types of tests they were asked. I remember that one of them was, can you recite the Constitution? This is real history. And I think a lot of people don't recognize it, that even with the Voting Rights Act, people of color, in particular Blacks, were still did not really have the right to vote. Voter suppression was just literally the order of the day. It's done differently now when we see things like what we've been seeing in the media, lines with people standing in for 3 and 4 and 5 hours. That is a form of discouragement, voter suppression, or people's turning in their ballots and the ballots not being counted. And so these kinds of concerns, the issue that you raised, Mr. Brown, it remains real today. We don't have to recite the Constitution, but voter suppression is real.
Absolutely. And one of the quite requirements or criteria was how many jelly beans is in a jar.
I did hear that.
I mean, if you think about that, but it's, and here we are today. And Mr. Morales and Mr. Vince, please chime in on this as you're out getting people to understand the importance of voting, the historical piece of it, and today. Either one of you can chime on in at first. Okay, Mr. Vincent, yeah. We'll go to the mayor.
Okay. Yeah, I'll go first. It's great. For me, I have two kids. So I have a 9-year-old and a 3-year-old, and I use this opportunity to share their importance. And and also I had my daughter even sit through Mr. Lewis's or Congressman Lewis's funeral service, and we talked through the things that he championed, especially the right to vote. And reporters have asked me, like, why would you take on such a thankless job? And I've come to understand over the years that representation matters, and who we vote and elect into office matters. I tend to stress that whenever I engage with folks in the community specifically, and we've seen that firsthand in Gresham, especially as we begin to start to have these conversations around equity over the last 2 years, and with the folks that were in office and how it was hard for them to unpack or even understand just the impacts of the various decisions. So I tend to go back off of the historical context and try to make it relevant for just the youth and the folks in our community as far as the importance of voting, especially here locally in the local elections.
Okay. Mr. Morales, would you go ahead and chime in on that? Mr. Morales?
Hello.
Yes.
Just this morning, actually, I put a call out to our community. I said, I'm going to be at this office of East County Rising. And if you need help with information on how to vote, stop on by. We're going to have information about candidates and initiatives. And we had a group of people who stopped by. And we marched to the local library and we delivered our ballots together. And there was children, there were immigrants in this group, recently individuals. And I said this to them, I said, the number one reason why today a lot of people who have the right to vote and don't vote is because of the trauma that has been put in place, like Dr. Colquitt said. All of these tests, all of these punishments, all of the fear about voting, that most people won't vote because they don't want to do it wrong. People won't vote because they don't think that they're going to vote for the right, that they're not informed. And so I sat down and I really went through, you know, how to vote. I said, you fill in the Scantron, black or blue ink, you fold that your ballot up, you put in the secret envelope, and don't forget to sign it, right? And it is a powerful thing when people are walked through that. I want to just build on one point, because I did launch my campaign for the mayoral candidate on the 55th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act. And I was really honored to have Desmond Mead from Florida on my call, as well as Latasha Brown, the founder of Black Voters Matter. And the reason why I had Desmond join, not only have we worked together to restore voting rights for 1.5 million returning citizens in Florida, but he continues to identify the issue about voter suppression that Dr. Colquitt talks about. The fact that African Americans and people of color are over incarcerated and then lose the right to vote, and then the hurdles to get that right to vote back, not to mention how expensive and the years that one has to wait, are still real forms of voter suppression. From the
we're gonna join Ms. Morales when we come back off with a break. Stay right there, this is gonna be foul. It's going to get deeper and deeper, okay? We'll see everybody.
Yeah, looking forward to it. Yeah.
We're gonna send everybody a link. Get back in.
Yeah, the link's on its way. Give me about 5 minutes. We'll start back up at 8:45.
Okay.
Okay.
This is a really great format.
Oh yeah, I appreciate it. It's all about getting the information from the people to the people.
That's right.
Okay, welcome back to another edition of Straight Talk. And where we left off at, Mr. Morales was sharing a little bit about his journey as teaching, sharing with people how to go and get out and vote and fill it out. Let's go back to that, because that was very, very powerful.
Thank you, yeah. And you know, so when we had people show up today, as everyone was depositing their ballot, I had them say why they were voting. And of course, some people said for change, for our families. And at the end, immigrant family said, we can't vote, but we're here because you all are voting for us.
Right.
And that's powerful, right? And I just wanted to say, like, from the, you know, colonizing, right, of this country.
Right.
The one debate this country has always had is who belongs and who doesn't.
Right.
Who's a citizen and who isn't? And what kind of rights do citizens get and who doesn't? And so I really love what you said, Mr. Brown, about like women getting the right to vote, then people of color getting the right to vote. I think the conversation is around whether at some point we let our immigrant community have the right to vote, and to ensure that we do what we can to remove voter suppression issues.
Right. And you know, I want to chime in on something, because I want to touch a little bit about, because people might not know that you come from like a family of 6 or 9 siblings, and you know, you're from Mexico, you know, and you've been moving around, you've been to the struggle. So I want people to know a little bit about who you are, Mr. Mayor. Oh, okay. I'm speaking into existence, but I want people to know a little bit about your struggle and who you are, the person. Go ahead.
You know, thank you so much, Mr. Brown. I appreciate the experience. You know, you're right. I'm the 9th child of a big immigrant family.
Yes.
Who landed in Los Angeles, East LA, during the time of real conflict, right, between particularly immigrant and Black communities.
Okay.
And I think that was heightened during the Rodney King riots as well. Grew up with 2 parents and eventually with a single mother. My father, became an alcoholic and very abusive. My mother is the most courageous person that I know. I could like to say she's my hero. One night in the middle of an episode with my father, you know, with $200 in her purse, she put us 5 kids in a car and we drove north. That's how we ended up in Oregon. And, you know, I've lost 2 brothers to guns.
Our condolences to you.
And I've lost a sister to addiction. And 2 of those deaths within the last 12 months. I say that I was a high school dropout. I ended up, that was right after my brother was shot in the head, that I dropped out of school and, you know, got into trouble. I was the first of my family who eventually graduated high school, went on to college.
Yes.
And I like to say that I'm not going to be the last, right? Like,
absolutely.
My thing is always like bringing other people along. But the reason I say that is because these situations are concentrated in communities that are under-resourced, right? That lack economic opportunity, the lack recreation and services for our families and our kids. And so I bring that with me into these positions, right? I'm empathetic. I relate to people because I've lived it. And these are not things that I read about or that, you know, I think altruistically are like the right things to do. These are the things that I lived through. And whether it was getting in trouble as a teenager, right? I used to drive uninsured because I couldn't afford insurance. Right. Between my 3 jobs, night school and high school. You know, I gave my friend an employee discount at Meyer & Frank. Most people, you know, were told to return the clothes or pay for it. you know, when I did it, the police was called, I was arrested, I had to return the clothes, pay the fees, and go to a week's program, and I'm still haunted by that, right? Sure. It's the thing that gets thrown back in my face, even though I'm public about it. I mean, I've testified about those things at the Capitol in Salem. I've testified about these things because it's a problem, right? To racially profile people and then to give harsh punishments to young people where we can destroy their lives. These are not restorative justice practices. And so recently, you know, my opponents try to throw those things in my face that really shame me and the community that live here. But you can't shame somebody who lives their truth, right? Absolutely. And you can't shame somebody who takes their lived experience and makes that their strength. And I think, you know, with Councilor Vince Jones-Dixon, and hopefully Ms. Palmer will run for office, and Dr. Colquitt, well, like, we have a lived experience that just makes us better about listening to community and making policy from a lived experience, right?
Right, and that's why I wanted to touch on the fact that what people can hear who you were and a little bit about your journey. I know just, you couldn't condense it in few minutes, but we touched on the fact of single mom, six siblings, working, got in a little trouble, but you raised up out of it. You took that and made it something to stand on. And so people can relate to that. A lot of times we get politicians or whatever in office and they haven't experienced anything. So everything's book knowledge and knowing the Constitution and knowing the laws, but people need somebody that had experienced something that can physically, emotionally connect to them. So I appreciate you sharing that with us. And Mr. Vincent, I'm gonna come to the doctor, but Mr. Vincent, I wanna share a little bit about your journey too. Now you are a father, got two children, but there's something to Mr. Vincent that people don't know. Share a little bit about it.
Yeah, well, thank you, Mr. Brown. And yeah, I'll start with, I'm number 4 out of 10 kids, and yeah, okay. I'm raised by my beautiful mother, Kimberly Dixon, and she's pretty active in Portland, Northeast Portland. She's on the crisis response team, and she's my filter. She's my rock. A little bit about myself. My father, my biological father, left when I was at the age of four, and then my dad that raised me between the ages of 4 and 12, he passed away unexpectedly, and he was an entrepreneur. And like most young men, you were trying to find your way, and you need a male role model in your life. And I've been looking for one for the last 20 years of my life. I think for me, some of the major things that have happened to me in my lifetime, or some of the things that drive me, is my family. Unfortunately, I lost my brother to community violence, or to gang violence, back in 2013. But the key thing to that, 3 months before he passed, he was describing Gresham, specifically Rockwood, and some of the needs in Rockwood and some of the things that he wanted to do. And that's what I used to, I guess I used that as my North Star as I began, actually throughout all the work that I've done in Gresham over the last 4 or 5 years, that's what I used to keep me grounded. And then professionally, I've worked in the death care industry for over 11 years. So while right after high school, I've been serving families in this industry, and now I work for a nonprofit in Rwanda. And I think all my experiences have prepared me for this next journey as it pertains to serving or continuing to serve on city council. And it helps inform the decisions that I make and just the priorities that I set for myself and my family. So,
and I appreciate you sharing that, because see, people now are able to connect. You know, issues are beautiful. And we're going to get into some of the issues, but the fact that you had a journey, you're a single mom, you have lost loved ones. So you know what that feels like. You know what that's needed. And that's what people connect to. Dr. Rose, I'm going to come to you. I'm going to get in your business a little bit too.
Okay. Well, before you get into my business, Mr. Brown, could I just, and you're welcome to get into my business. I have a boring life. I just wanted to thank counselors, Dixon and Morales, for touching that special place in each of us in terms of what their journey is like. There is that expression, you don't really know me unless you know my story. And so that's very important. And when I hear these things and they touch me in that space, it's very important. It gives me the energy to continue doing the work that I do, which is to work to get candidates elected and to focus and work on the issues that are important to creating a better tomorrow than what we had yesterday, and a better tomorrow for our children and our future grandchildren, and just a society that we can say has a semblance of democracy, of equality and justice, and all of these things that we think are pretty utopian, when in fact they are a part of what we believe to be a democracy. So I just thank both of them for their stories. So now we can get into all that other stuff.
Yeah, and what I meant by that is I wanted the people to know a little bit about you and how you got on your journey.
Well, and thank you for asking me that. I actually grew up in a military family with, my dad was an Army sergeant and my mother did hair. She did the kind, she didn't have a cosmetology degree. She did hair, as they used to say in the South, in the kitchen. And you can actually, I bet you know about that, Mr. Brown. But one of the things that, and they both mom and dad were active in the NAACP. And so even from the time I was a kid, my dad always had, he wore a vest, and then when he didn't wear his military uniform, he had on a vest. And inside of the vest pocket, there was always a voter registration card. It doesn't look like they look now. We're going back to when I was in grade school, but dad always had a voter registration card. And he didn't talk about it out loud. He was whispering to people, You registered to go down there and vote, aren't you? He would say that to everybody, no matter who we met. And so I learned very early about registering to vote. And dad would say, your vote is you have power in your vote. There's power in your vote. And he would say, it left up to the white folks, you're not gonna get to vote. He said, left up to the white folks, they'll put you back out there in the cotton field. That's exactly what dad would say. And he was an older gentleman. In fact, he was 50 when I was born. So I got the old school stuff. Yeah, he was 50 and my mother was 40. So I had older parents. But the other thing that was pressed in my family was you have to have an education. My father said, it's wonderful to grow up and be married and have children, have your own kids and your family and your home, but it's very important that you're educated. He believed that there's many roads to the future and there's many ways to do well in life, and he believed one of those was education. And I can remember him saying, he's been deceased many years, but I can remember him saying, if you don't get your education, somebody's going to try to put their foot on your neck and they're going to leave it there. Wow. And I thought about my father saying that when at the death of George Floyd, just the symbolism of the man putting his foot on his neck until he could no longer breathe.
Right. You know, and I appreciate you sharing that with us, because I knew there was something that, you know, people are viewing this, and you're administrator for the women, for the Biden and Harris, and your Democratic chairperson, but they needed to know what moved you. Now let's get into some of the issues. One of the first issues I want to address is defunding. There's a myth going on about what defunding means. So doctor, if you will, a little bit, and then we're going to go to the Mr. Vincent, then we're going to go to Mr. Morales, because I know that's, you all have been asked about defunding the police. So go ahead, doctor.
Yeah, well, I did ask this question. The Black Caucus, again, I chaired that part of the Democratic Party organization. That question was asked to just about all of the nonpartisan candidates that we interviewed. And we tried to ask questions about which we had some concern as a part of the Black community, which we were representing. And so we had an idea of what we thought about defunding. And in general, the defunding, and we got pros and cons, yes, defund, no, not to defund. Mm-hmm. But where we are is the money needs to be appropriated to certain types of programs that police are not necessarily trained to handle. With mental health issues, there may need to be a mental health practitioner. and money might be better well spent going into that type of program, but just a blanket defunding without a plan as to where the money would go and how that money would then be used to better stabilize the community and to protect it against police violence or inappropriate police behavior, police brutality. So the idea is if monies are not used, that we make sure that they're used appropriately for the proper programs, but just a blanket defunding does not seem realistic.
Yeah, and Mr. Vincent, go ahead and chime in on that.
Yeah, I thank you for the question, Mr. Brown and Dr. Colquitt. I totally agree with your what you shared already. Whenever one says defund, I always think define. We have to define what does that mean for us in Gresham specifically. And even the police, they're all for the Gresham Police Department, I met with them 2 or 3 weeks ago. They're all for reallocating resources to folks, to teams and or organizations that specialize in areas such as mental health response and what have you. So I echo your sentiments, and that's we just have to create space for these conversations to happen. I can only speak for the Gresham Police Department. They would like the same thing as far as reallocation and being clear as far as what that means. And we have to create space for those conversations to happen.
Absolutely. Mr. Morales, sir?
Yeah, I will just chime on and say that, you know, some of the safest neighborhoods are those that have the least amount of police. And so I think that we have tried to police our way out of poverty. We've tried to police our way out of mental health issues. You know, and the truth is, right now here in Gresham, 47% of our budget goes to the police.
Okay.
Right. And very little goes to economic development. Very little goes to community services. Community development. And we definitely need to be allocating resources to some of the stuff that was talked about by Dr. Colquitt: mental health, addiction services, workforce development programs, housing programs to get people back on their feet. And, you know, even the way that we handle homelessness, right? Like, we try to criminalize homeless people and police them out. Well, we know that recidivism rates don't go down when you just don't get to the root of the issues. And, you know, I'm really glad that we have Ms. Palmer here with Go Get Your Child, because these are the types of programs that are going to actually help get to the root of the issues. It's not just simply more and more policing. And so when I hear defund the police, I actually think that our community is saying strict policing alone is not helping. We need investments in the community, in community development, economic development, these services, and housing.
The reason I was getting on that question is because there's a myth out there that people say defunded, that means we're not going to have any more police. And right. The community is going to be at will of whomever. And so I want to just, because I know that's a question that you're all been asked as you pioneer your way and do what you're doing. So I wanted to get that out there, that you, each one of you, we're not talking about police, you don't have no more money, you don't have right. no more jobs. We're not talking about that. We're talking about allocating to other resources, which officers have said, hey, I'd rather for someone with that expertise go out there too. Another issue I want to talk about, and I don't know if people realize it, well, maybe they do, maybe they don't. We got people pushing for Supreme Court justice. They want her in before November 10th. Why? Okay, November 10th, they're going to be addressing health care, quote, Obamacare. So can each one of you touch a little bit about what are you telling the people out there about what's going on about this health care? We'll start with Mr. Morales' time, and then we'll go to Ms. Vincent, and then we'll go to the doctor.
Well, you know, one, I think they need a... let me say straight talk, pump the brakes on trying to get stack the Supreme Court with a bunch of conservative people who want to undo everything that the Obama administration and the progress that we made in this country, right? And so We know that millions of people would lose their coverage of pre-existing conditions if they got rid of Obamacare or the ACA, right?
Right.
They purposely use Obamacare to weaponize the issue, right? Uh-huh. It's the Affordable Care Act. A lot of us would not even have access to healthcare if it were not for that. Now, I know Oregon is a different story. We do have the Oregon Health Plan, and we've been covering even our undocumented population as well, right? But we have a measure right now, measure 110 here, that would increase addiction, mental health, mostly addiction services and resources for the community. It would also prevent criminalizing and locking up people for addiction or small drug crimes, right? I think that that's important because one in two Oregonians die of an addiction issue every day.
Oh my goodness.
Okay. And when you look at those numbers, those are our communities. Absolutely. These are our communities, and we get incarcerated at higher rates. I know that it seems like that doesn't tie into the Supreme Court, but it does, because when you're talking about health, you're talking about community health as well, and our communities are disproportionately impacted by healthcare coverage. And so they should hold off until after the election. Mm-hmm. And if, I know this may not be popular, but if they do put somebody, I hope that when Biden and Kamala Harris win, that they will take action to expand the number of people on the Supreme Court and appoint other people to bring more balance to it.
Mr. Vincent, you want to chime in a little bit on that?
Yeah, actually, I'm going to pass my time to Dr. Colquitt because I haven't looked into the issue. Okay. But I would echo everything that Council Morales has mentioned.
I appreciate that about you, because that was just straight talk. That's like, hey, I'm going to pass this because I haven't looked into it. You know, and that's real people. That's real people. That's a real, go ahead, doctor.
Well, listen, I want to thank Councilor Dixon because I am just stewing. Oops, something happened to my picture. Is my picture still there?
Are you still up there, doctor?
Okay, all right. Let me tell you something. I am just stewing over this whole issue, to be quite straight talk, as we call it.
Yeah.
I expect that Judge Barrett will become a Supreme Court justice by way of a vote that's happening as early as tomorrow. And I'm glad that you ask us about the push of the Republican Party. And I think most of the senators have even used the word despicable. I know Hillary got in trouble using the word deplorable, but there are times when we need to stand up and speak our truth and deal straightforward with what's happening here. Confirming a Supreme Court justice when an election is already underway in the final 20, 30 days before an election, when President Obama was denied the right to have a hearing for Merrick Garland. And if I'm not mistaken, he had upwards of 10 months left in his tenure as our president. But there are some, I am so glad you asked this question, Mr. Brown. This, seating this particular person, and I think Council Morales spoke earlier about colonizing, and it's very important that we understand what a colonizer is when we look at the background of Judge Barrett. But there are some other things that are at risk here, certainly primarily her being there to hear on the, I think it's the 10th of November, they're going to look at the Affordable Care Act. Yes. And I think we all believe, and I certainly hope we're wrong, but we all believe that she is there to be a part of a decisive vote to strike down the Affordable Care Act, which has been the mantra of Donald Trump since his election. But
and Dr. Rosa, why have you two, as you mm-hmm. go on, I want you to also touch on Roe versus Wade, because that's coming
up
too. Okay.
Right.
Okay,
I was going to say that some other things that are on the Supreme Court docket, which makes the appointment of Barrett all the more dangerous and enough to bring to put people into a state of distraught is that overturning Roe v. Wade. And as long as we've had Roe v. Wade, it guaranteed women's right to reproductive health care. That came with what many of us literally fell asleep believing was settled law. But there's also things that we know that Barrett is against, LGBTQ plus rights and trans rights. You asked earlier about the Voting Rights Act. That's on the ballot, the right to vote, the right to equal pay for equal work for women. There's also workers' rights to collectively bargain. Lots of things that she's spoken about in past decisions that are causing great distress. The right to clean air and clean water is on the ballot. Climate is on the ballot. Also, the dreamers' ability to avoid deportation. Of all the people, when I say I'm stewing, of all the folks that Donald Trump could have brought forward to put, to have confirmed, to hear different cases that are very much at risk, I think Barrett is probably the worst of the worst. And she's also one of the attorneys who participated in Bush v. Gore, one of those attorneys who decided, she was a judge at the time, I'm sorry, not an attorney, but they decided in favor of Bush when there was Gore v. Bush. And I think that Donald Trump may be anticipating that this election could go before the Supreme Court. But if we all go out and vote to make sure that we have a decisive election, then it won't appear before her. But I've seen a lot of travesties as an activist from undergraduate school to now. But absolutely, this is one of the worst. So now I'll stop stewing.
That's okay. Keep on stewing, because I think that's going to give you more energy. But I want another one of the issues I want to touch on is housing. Okay, we see skyscrapers going up all around Portland, Oregon, but we also see people in tents. Now, I've sat and talked to some of them volunteer, just because that's what they want to do it, but a whole lot of them is mental issues, don't have a place to stay. And so can each one of you chime in a little bit on, as you are on the campaign trail, how are you addressing the issue of homelessness? Mr. Morales, I think we went to you first. Mr. Vincent, we'll go to you first, the doctor, and then back to Mr. Morales.
Sure. Yeah, one of the things that I've heard, Council.
Oh. And Mr. Brown, we have Ms. Palmer on here too.
She okay. Wants to oh. Do. Okay. We'll bring you right on. Let me get Mr. Vincent to touch on that, and then we're going to bring Ms. Palmer in.
Yeah, Council Morales, he mentions a couple all the time when we're asked these questions. He said we should lead with compassion first. Uh-huh. And I believe we're doing that in Gresham in East County, as far as we have a livability program or director or manager that actually goes out and meets with folks that are houseless and tries to provide some guidance and direction as it pertains to temporary housing and services that they may need and services that the city offers. I would like to see us build on that. And work with our houseless community as far as coming up with solutions that work for them and for the community, and then also let the community know that that program is available. So that I'll, seeing that we have Ms. Palmer here, I'm gonna save my time for other folks to chime in too.
Oh, I appreciate that. And we have an inspirational speaker. She's an activist in the Black community. She has a program called Boss Up Academy, and she's also an author. Yeah, we can hear you now. Go ahead, inspirational speaker.
Okay.
Head of the
Boss Up. Thank you so much for having me.
Boss Up Academy. Go ahead.
Thank you so much, Tony, for having me on your show.
It's a pleasure.
And also the candidates on the show, the mayor, running for mayor, and Vince and Doctor. Yeah. You know, I met her before, and so she's a great lady as well. But I want to speak to you in regards to housing. What Human Solution is doing for housing, because I live in one of the buildings, they okay. have organized a program called ROC, Residents Organizing for Change. And so what we do is we go down to the Capitol, we get residents to the Capitol in Salem, and talk to them about fair housing, which is not fair housing. I live in the unit right now. I'm paying 70% of my income for rent, and I'm on SSD. So a lot of families are being affected by, they saying, fair rent, higher, I mean, than their income.
Okay, you breaking up again?
No. And I also want to talk to you in regards to when you were saying about the homeless. We passed a bill where they're going to be having a lot of services for the homeless. So, I mean, that stuff is just now starting. So we're still seeing them out there, but they have outreach people that's going out there to talk to them about housing, doing assessments and trying to get them into housing. But we still need to vote for housing. When you see housing where it could be affordable for us, please vote for that.
I appreciate you. And talk a little bit about the title of your book. You're author of the book, Trauma. Tell the people a little bit about that.
I'm writing the book.
Okay.
It's going to be coming soon. So, Tragedy to Triumph.
Okay.
The Laurie Palmer story, A Rose City. Now, let me tell you about the thorns. And the thorns are the things that I have went through in this community. I'm born and raised here. And I had a son that was shot in this community 6 times, but he lived. And that's why I do Go Get Your Child from 2015 to now. I'm still on the front line when it comes to violence. You know, and it's sad to say that it's a lot of violence still going on. So we need to address that. But I am on the front lines as a parent, as a consultant in this community. It's really important to vote, you know.
Well, we really appreciate you being on the front lines. I'm going to go over to Mr. Morales, and we're going to address the issue about homeless, because I know people are probably asking you that as you're on the campaign trail. Mr. Morales?
Yeah, you know, like Councilor Vince Jones-Dixon said, you know, I always say we got to start with compassion, right?
Okay.
And that we have to make sure we're creating the safety net around our community members. So when people do hit these moments in life, we're there to kind of pick people back up. I think part of it is what you're talking about, creating enough of a housing supply to provide people steady housing and safe housing, more programs. And I think Ms. Palmer was talking about this initiative Here Together, which we just all passed here in Multnomah County, which will be bringing in millions of dollars to organizations like Human Solutions, who are providing job training, addiction counseling services for our community. And, you know, I think with workforce development programs and apprenticeship programs, we can get people back on their feet, right? What we cannot do, and which is what we have been doing, is criminalizing our homeless community.
Okay. Now, I want to touch on this, but I want to come back to this, but I want to touch on this climate control issue. Whoever would like to chime in on it, because that's an issue too with a lot of people. Because if we don't get a handle on this, it's going to get worse and worse. And so since I have you right here, Mr. Morales, go ahead. We got the break. Oh my goodness! You know what? If the time just went so fast. My goodness.
We'll have to come back and hang out with you again.
It'd be a pleasure. I'll be honored, because like we say, Straight Talk is a show that cares about you, where the information comes from the people to the people. So better education now, people. Better food to eat, people. Better housing, people need. Understand that people need.